You're welcome back to the Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. Our first big conversation is about, you know, a particular story that has stayed with us for years and years and years. And it's about the petroleum industry bill, PIB. Finally, the Senate passed this after about 2 hours of deliberations. And we've invited energy expert Mr. Bala Zaka to shed some more light on it. Good morning, Mr. Zaka.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me.
Yes. So, first of all, what would you say are the major highlights of this petroleum industry bill, just to break that down?
Well, the first and the important highlight is that it's better late than never. Oh, it's better very, 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 very late than never. I think that is just the summary. And another point I want to put across here is this. Any issue that has to do with national interest, our political leaders should put their political differences or affiliations apart and make sure national interest is at the front burner. Yes, the petroleum industry bill has eventually been or has finally been passed into law. We are waiting for the president to assent to it. But as we speak today, I can tell you it's almost as good as dead on arrival because all the investors have gone. The investors have gone to better, safer, and probably cheaper heavens. You're talking about a bill that has been there for the past 10 years or over a decade. Just ask yourself a very simple question. If you were sent by your country home, you know, or by your company from overseas to come to Nigeria, you know, and you come here and you set up a management and you have been waiting for the past 10 years to start working because you were waiting for the Nigerian government or leadership to put regulatory standards in place. Believe me, your home country is going to fire you. Remember that when you go to invest, or generally when investors go to invest, they either collect loans or they rely on shareholders' funds. If you collect, if you collected loans, expect that you are going to pay what we call cost of capital. Or if you were relying on the shareholders' funds, you were supposed to be paying them dividends. So will shareholders wait for you for more than 10 years and you tell them we are waiting for regulatory standards? They will fire your management and fire everybody. So it's better late than never. That's just the summary.
All right, Mr. Bala Zaka, you mentioned that what we're waiting for now is assent by the president. If you remember, also the 8th National Assembly, headed by Bukola Saraki back then, also passed this bill, but it wasn't signed by the president. And so is there any hope that it might be different now? And then also, there is a part of it that you know states 30%, I believe, for oil exploration in northern Nigeria. Do you think we should still be investing that much in oil exploration in the north, seeing where the world is going with regards to clean energy?
Yes, when you talk about energy, if some countries are still using coal, and these countries or nations are industrial nations, if they are still using coal to drive energy or to generate energy, to be honest, Nigeria, as a third world country and as a very, very poor country, it's too early for Nigeria to start thinking of doing away with fossil fuel. Fossil fuel will be here for some time to come. Because like I said, some countries are still using coal and some of those countries are developed nations. So to that extent, please, I want us to disabuse our minds when it comes to global move. You know, this is not like the case of GSM that we were forced to go into. GSM was a technology that came and we needed to key into it. But in terms of fossil fuel, yes, we of course, we need to reduce pollution. We need to be conscious of carbon emission, greenhouse gas effects and the rest. But please, let's not get into that. Let's talk about the basic things we need. Let's be able to even use our natural gas to get ammonia, get fertilizer, and urea, and the rest, and get food. Let's be able to even have basic electricity. If you look at it, it is because we cannot afford electricity. That's why we go to the petrol station to buy petrol, and most of the time we buy diesel to come and run our generators. You know, when you look at it from that angle, most of these countries you are talking about, electricity is not part of their problems. You know, so to that extent, please let's stop bothering ourselves about that drive, because Nigeria has not, we cannot even produce the spoke of a tire. But let me, this petroleum industry, let me tell you, as I speak to you today, when you talk about drilling campaigns, quote me anywhere as I speak to you, as of today, you don't have up to 7 drilling rigs in Nigeria drilling today. In the world of Nigeria, there was a time when only one company will have more than 7 rigs drilling, active drilling. There was a time when Nigeria as a country will have up to 50, sometimes 40 drilling rigs, active drilling. Then the question you ask is, where are many or most of these companies? They've all gone due to business climate hostilities. Some of them were waiting for regulatory standards so that they will know their corporate social responsibility obligations and some of their civic responsibilities to government, like tax obligation, royalties, and other levies. So they've waited and they are all gone. So please, to, as far as I'm concerned, we have delayed so much. And something I noticed, that was why at the beginning of this discussion, I said, anytime we want to talk about national issues, let national interests come to mind. Before the present political dispensation came, we had a PIB document that was 223-page document. That was the main document then. And I'm surprised that when you ask me something about frontier exploration and the rest, those were the same thing. Then we had only 3 contending issues. One was the power of the minister. The yes. second one was how to take care of host communities. Then the third one was frontier exploration. But when after the other dispensation left, you know, and a new government came in, the first thing they did was to broke down, I mean, to break down, balkanize that PIB. Okay. And they said it was too voluminous. And they started with petroleum industry governance bill, another bill on fiscal regime, another bill on host communities. After going round and round and round for more than 6 years, they have now come back again and are trying to go back to probably that same document and are calling it consolidated bill. So when you look at the way we behave in Nigeria, honestly to me, sometimes when I look at national issues, this democratic dispensation and politics have done more harm to Nigerians than good. Because after going round and round, prodigalizing, we have now come back and are still talking about the same 3 contending issues. So the question was, why were we putting political differences and affiliation and probably sectionalism and sectarianism before public interest or national interest?
So Mr. Zakar, I want us to talk extensively on one of those issues you mentioned. That's the host communities, the clause 240. What really is the bone of contention regarding, you know, these host communities between the Senate and the House?
God bless you, my sister, for that question. But let me talk about just the 3 contending issues then. The 3 contending issues were, 1, the power of the minister. You know, the second one, like I said, host community concerns. Then the third one, frontier exploration. So then what happened was people felt the minister was too powerful and was abusing the power. But I keep telling people, when you feel a minister is too powerful, you cannot in a bill, a national document that has to do with international product and international relationship, you can't, because of that, start thinking of whittling down the powers of a minister. Because every country you go to, the minister for defense is always a powerful minister. The minister for finance is always a powerful minister. The minister for energy, in our own case, petroleum, this will always be a powerful minister. So if you feel the minister was abusing his or her powers, what you needed to do now, as we're discussing the bill, was to now start coming up with criteria or standards on how to search for and recruit the right person that will sit on that chair as the petroleum minister. You don't look at the human being and you feel, because either the human being was showing signs of profligacy, then you say you are not happy with him or her and whittle down the power. That was where they got it wrong. Then the second one had to do with host community. So when you are talking about host community, what they simply needed to have done, they was to define what constituted a host community. During that time, when people had so much interest in the PIB, then scholars, financial institutions, local investors, international investors, some of us started coming up with what was going to even be the likely definition of a host community and how they should be treated. If I could remember then, personally to me, I felt a host community should be that community that is associated with the physical extraction of oil and gas. When you talk about that, it simply means even within a local government, there will be some communities that you cannot get crude oil and gas. So to that extent, that community does not qualify as a host community. But we know that there are so many places and areas even across the country that are impacted by activities of crude oil or oil and gas. Like you have some places that do not have crude oil at all, but they have depots. You have some places that have so many depots, landing points for crude oil, and they experience pollution or they get impacted. Those kind of communities, you can give them their own definition. But a host community should be that community where you have physical extraction of oil and gas. In other words, when you take an example of a place like Lagos, if Ikeja has, if you can get physical oil and gas in within Ikeja in Lagos, then Ikeja axis, all communities qualify. But if Victoria Island does not have crude oil and gas in the reservoir or at the subsurface or down there, then Ikeja may never qualify, even though all of them are within the same state. So all they needed to do was to come up with the proper definition and come up with how they are going to genuinely assign something or allot something or apportion something or appropriate something to take care of the kind of degradation that the communities will be experiencing, like biodegradation and how to bioremediate them. That was the main thing about host community. Then the other one that we were talking about, frontier exploration. If you look at Nigeria, we have what we call potential basins. So when you have basins, you know, you look at all the basins and come up with how to take care of them. But the first major prolific basin is the Niger Delta Basin. So the Niger Delta Basin, we have already established it is prolific. We have so much oil, crude oil that is even feeding the country today. So you will come up with how you will treat them. Then the next one is recently we have discovered oil around Lagos axis. But geologically, Lagos belongs to that basin we call Dahomey Basin. And you can come up with the assessment of the quantity. So for the basin where we have oil around Lagos, it does not qualify as Niger Delta Basin. Then when you move from the Niger Delta Basin, you go towards Anambra Basin. There are some states, they are not part of Niger Delta, but those basins there, you know, you have crude oil and gas. So we call that basin Anambra Basin. Then as you go towards the north, recently oil was discovered around two places we geologically or geographically call Benue Trough into Gungula Basin. You will now come up with how you are going to treat it because the quantity of oil and gas and other things are different. Then we have some basins that we have not discovered through oil or gas, like Sokoto Basin. You have the Bida Basin and the Lechad Basin. No, so what you will do is, depending on what has been discovered, you come up with how to treat them. All those things were discovered then during the, I'm sorry, I don't want to call the name, but I can call the name now, during the time of the Zeani. So they came up with that document. But before we knew, a new government came, some politicians came, and they began to balkanize everything. They broke it into four, call it PIGB, PI blah blah, PI blah blah. And after wasting more than 6 years again, post the document of the Zeani Alice Madueke, now we have gone back to where we started. So national interest, please, should always be at the forefront, not political interest.
Mr. Zaka, so you don't have any faith in the conversations concerning 3% or 5% for host communities. You don't think that, no, you know, is in any way going to be useful?
No, those discussions were unnecessary, but the question is, why I'm not happy is Investors have waited and waited and they have all gone.
Yeah, but isn't it possible that we can... Yeah, Mr. Zaka, one of the things that the bill hopes to achieve is transparency and accountability, or better transparency and accountability with regards to the petroleum sector. So don't you think, you know, there's a possibility that we, you know, can bring in more investors or newer investors now that the bill is going, you know, has been passed, and hopefully the president will assent to it this time?
You see, I'm a loyal citizen and I like being honest and straightforward. The business climate hostility now is 10 times higher than it was probably 10 years ago. If investors have run away, now look at the value of even the Naira. Look at the disposable income. Look at the inflation. Look at even look at the balance of trade today. It's almost going negative. So almost all the indices of the GDP today are heading towards zero. So things are worse now. So what we are saying is this: why did we allow those delays? We're not saying investors will not come. That was why I started by saying, hey, when you are talking about investors, they are after better, safer and cheaper havens. They've been waiting in Nigeria. They've been waiting. In fact, some companies have been thrown into liquidation because they couldn't keep waiting. They needed to pay interest and cost of capital. And if you look at it again, internally again within Nigeria, to some extent now, there are so many things that are still not going right. We decided, you're talking about a country that still cannot even be able to refine. You have a country of 200 million citizens, and you want those citizens to go and rely on import of a sensitive material like refined petroleum products. Where does that thing happen? You have a country that has more than 100 universities, with a premier university that came up in 1948. And refining is elementary and basic chemistry. And that country cannot be able to fix refineries or even construct new ones. Let me tell you, when we started this PIB, there were some East African countries and West African countries that came and copied the initiative from us. And their own equivalent of PIB has been passed into law. And they have attracted and taken over all the investors. So that was why when I said investors have moved to cheaper and safer havens, that was what I was talking about. They copied from Nigeria's PIB, set up their own, you know, passed theirs into law with attractive conditions. And all the investors have gone there. So let's be honest to ourselves. It's good that it has been passed. It's better late than never. But I'm telling you, I've already said it before. As we speak today, quote me, as at the date of today, there are no up to 7 active drilling rigs. Doesn't that tell you something? Even the price of crude oil is rising in the international market. Only quote me between now and December, and let us see how many new investors will come.
So what positives? Balazaka, what positives can you point out? Because like you said, better late than never. So there has to be something that you can point out to say, okay, at least we can achieve this in the next few years if this bill is assented to and fully implemented. So what should Nigerians expect in, you know, in a positive direction?
Okay, the positive is this. At least after foot dragging, after using political punctuation, sectional punctuation, tribal punctuation, at least at the end of the day, the petroleum industry bill has been passed. That is a positive one, because at least we are now on the track, right? We hope and pray that Mr. President will assent to it. Because if Mr. President does not assent to it, it will not become a law. So investors, the few investors that still have faith in Nigeria are still waiting. They will still be hanging and they may review their decision. So that positivity that has been achieved by at least the legislators is a plus for us. We pray that the relationship between the legislative arm and the executive arm this time around will be a positive one, and the president will assent to it. And when the president assents to it, one way or the other, investors are always ready to retrace, reanalyze, and recalibrate their business strategies. And we may see some of them coming back to Nigeria, including local investors.
Okay, so basically, Mr. Balazaka, I'm trying to get exactly where you stand regarding the passage of the PIB. So if the president assents to this, would you say it to be a guarantee that this would be basically a great policy environment for attracting investors into Nigeria's oil sector?
Sure. You know, when you have, because now that the president has not assented to it, it has not become a law. Remember when they came and broke down or balkanized the original PIB into four? They completed work on the Petroleum Industry Governance Bill. The president didn't assent to it, so it didn't become a law. But you see, what makes investors to go into a country, first of all, is stability of your social activities. But the first one is the law. Once something is a law, they will, because the law will be binding. So if the president assents to it, of course it has become a law. They can hold us on to that. We can hold them on to that. You understand? Then other things, we can now be looking at other things. Insecurity is everywhere. There is insecurity in Nigeria. There is insecurity in Asia, in the Americas, in Europe. Those ones, you can look into them. But the key thing is, where you don't have laws that have been concluded, it's very risky to go to those places to carry out businesses, because you can come and think royalty is probably 10%, or corporate social responsibility, which is not the necessary obligation, is X. Then once you go there and you discover it is Y, what do you do? When you discover that maybe you need to pay a given amount as tax, you understand? But it has not been passed into law. What if at the point of passing the law, the executive said, no, we will not accept this, go and change the tax percentage or this levy from X to Y? What will an investor do? That's why investors always say, no matter how bad the law is or how good, at least pass it. So even when we were talking about the other political dispensation, we were not saying in the days of the other regime, the law of the PIB would have been fantastic. No. What we are saying is, investors are waiting. Please tell us how the laws are. Because when you know the law, you can manage and pass. I always use an example of a relationship. If you talk to a lady can marry an alcoholic. A lady can marry somebody that is even more educated than. But the first thing, present what you have, present your credentials to that lady or that guy. The person can look at it and think about how to manage. And you people will have a peaceful relationship. So that's how it is in law. You may have laws, you may have taxes that are high or whatever. Investors may still be willing to manage and look at how to survive with you mutually, to mutually benefit. But as long as that thing has not become a law, it can be risky, it can destroy them, and it can destroy the relationship between you, the host country, the investors also, whether they are local investors or international investors.
Okay, Mr. Zaka, you're saying, first of all, we need this to become law, and even just as important, we need security in the country, because no one wants to invest in a place where they are not guaranteed that the assets are safe. So, yes, we note that. And there's I found a report from the Columbia Center for Sustainable Investment, and they basically spoke extensively about the PIB in Nigeria. They say, and I quote, that the PIB ultimately fails to account for climate change. The PIB fails to acknowledge the Paris Agreement. It fails to address the need for diversification to adequately prepare Nigeria for the energy transition that is already underway. Do you agree with this stance by the CCSI?
It's a yes and a no answer. The reason why I'm saying this is to this, and this is the reason why I don't like the way our politicians behave, because that report you are talking is basically talking about our sensibilities. All of us know that there are issues with climate change. All of us know that there is a need to move away from fossil fuel. We all know that it's a kind of global consensus that we need to move away from pollution. So to that extent, I want to agree that I want to disagree, because we as Nigerians, we are conscious, and we know that sometimes when you make some of these laws, you can always carry out adjustment. The reason why I disagree to that to some extent with that report is Nigerians themselves know that they are suffering from what we call environmental pollution, especially around the Niger Delta area as a result of gas flaring. Because when you have this gas flaring, it goes into the atmosphere and it mixes and comes down as what we call acid rain. So Nigerians already on their own are suffering from all kinds of breathing and bronchial problems, even before talking about climate change. So to that extent, Nigerians are ready to kick in. It is because when you delay and you are not active and you don't come up with this law, that's why people will take advantage and say that you are not serious. But Nigeria honestly is conscious. Then one of the reasons why I can continue to tell you that Nigeria is conscious but is not ready is because when you look at our gas, we've not been able to harness our gas because we don't have enough infrastructures. Once we have enough infrastructures in place, of course, gas flaring will stop. And once you stop gas flaring, then a greater part of the pollution that normally happens to the atmosphere is eliminated. Then the other one, there will be general social campaign. All this vandalism, breaking of pipelines, where crude oil will spill into the environment and biodegrade the environment, destroy what we call freshwater aquifers, then destroy streams and also the animals in the river, or what you call aquatic animals. That one has to do with sensitization. Because once you sensitize people, to some extent, if there is no vandalism, then you will not destroy freshwater aquifers. If there is no vandalism, you will not biodegrade the farms. If there is no vandalism, you are not going to destroy aquatic animals. So all this we knew, but because we were delaying, you see another country or some institutions are telling us as if we are a melancholy country. So that was why I said it's a yes and a no answer. It is yes because we delayed, but it is no because we were conscious. It was something ordinary we would have taken care of.
All right. Balazaka, final question from me is going to be on some of the reactions that I've seen. And I brought this up earlier about the 30%, which is meant to be used for exploration in the north. I've seen reactions to this and people saying, why are you giving 3% to host communities and 30% to oil exploration in the north? So I want you to go back to that once again. And then also on the same thing, do you think it's high time that we start to take funds from oil and invest in different other sectors? For example, information technology. It doesn't necessarily have to be in clean energy per se, but some of these funds should be able to open up a new space or invest in a new direction for where Nigeria's economy should be in the next, you know, decade.
God bless you for that question, my brother. That was what we were supposed to have done right from the time we discovered oil. Because when you talk about the Middle East, you see everybody running Dubai. Dubai has only one product, and that's crude oil and gas. So, and when you sell your crude oil and gas, whether you are Nigeria or Dubai or Brazil or Congo or Saudi Arabia, what comes to you is called petrodollars. It is what you do with your petrodollars that differentiates you between Nigeria and Saudi Arabia, between Nigeria and Dubai, between Nigeria and Ghana, or between Nigeria and China. So when I hear people saying crude oil is a cause, no. The difference between us and countries like United Arab Emirates is this. In the case of Nigerians or Nigerian leaders, some of them that were corrupt, when the petrodollars come, instead of investing, diversifying, and setting up information industries like you talk about, hospitality industry like you talk about, good health facilities, good education and schools. What many of our leaders were doing was they were using the petrodollars to go and be buying properties and houses in UK, in Asia, and the Americas. And that's why people like me ask, how many Germans, how many Americans, how many Saudi Arabians, how many people from the Middle East have we seen coming here to buy houses or coming to our hospitals? So why are our own leaders, you know, siphoning our monies and going there? So you are 100% correct, sir. The petrodollar is not a cause. It is what you use it to do that makes it a cause. And a practical example is the Middle East. The only product they have is one called crude oil. So from what they have used the petrodollars to do, if we have leaders that have national interests at heart, we can transform Nigeria and develop it to even better than the Middle East. But if we continue to have our leaders who do not put their thinking cap, if we continue to have the wrong economic managers as our leaders, we will never get out of the woods.
All right, Mr. Balazaka. Thank you very much. So it seems that really wraps up and leads to the conversation about anti-corruption in the country. Energy expert Balazaka, thank you very much for joining us on The Breakfast this morning.
Thank you for having me.
All right, so we're moving the conversation now from oil and gas to security. We know that Sunday Buho has been declared a wanted man by the DSS. Let's talk more about that after the break.